It is more than just a brew. In India, it is a wake-up call. From restaurants like this to every street corner, anywhere and everywhere, chai is the drink we live by. No morning can start without it, conversations are often around it, and even our Prime Minister chooses to speak to us over it. Historian Dr. Mohsina Mukaddam has spent a lot of time studying the journey of Indian food and tea in particular. And she has a tale to tell about how India turned to tea. It is quite a story, especially given the fact that even 100 years ago, very few Indians had even heard of tea. Dr. Mukaddam, it's been a long time. We've been planning to do this chai pe charcha of our own kind. Yes. And so I'm very glad that you're here. Now tell me, chai is something that every household starts the day with. Yes. The fact that it is a new entrant, how do you see it as a historian?
As a historian, I see that how a propaganda and publicity can change your dietary practices. Yeah. Okay, a drink which was not on horizon of Indian dietics till 100 years ago has become a very important part of our daily life. How history and how politics, economics, commercial interest can make you change your belief or make you change your idea of a particular beverage or particular food. If you ask me for one example, then I will say it is chai or tea. So we'll start from the beginning. So it is in 1778 that for the first time, Sir Joseph Bank, who was a botanist for East India Company, was asked to recommend one plant, commercial plant, and he recommended tea plant to be cultivated in India, especially in Northeast India, because he found that that area is suitable for cultivation of tea.
Sure.
But at that time, not much attention was paid to his recommendation. And why it was not paid? Because at that time, East India Company had the monopoly of tea trading with China. And they were not ready to have a competition for them in India. And therefore, not much attention was paid to his recommendation. Then later on, when Robert Bruce, he was also suggested that Assam or this region is suitable for tea cultivation. We also had our tea plants, what we can call as a wild tea plants, and the tea was consumed by the natives of Assam. So tea was not completely a new drink, but it was drunk by the aborigines. It was known only to them, and it was consumed more as a medicinal brew rather than a enjoyable beverage. Yeah. So Robert Bruce later on was hailed as a father of Indian tea, but at that time when he suggested that one should look at cultivation of tea in Assam, again the same issue, he was not taken seriously. Then in 1833, East India Company lost their monopoly of tea in China.
Sure.
And by that time England had become quite addicted to tea. So there was hue and cry raised that now we must get our cup of tea, and it must be from some other part of world, but we must have it. And therefore they brought pressure, and that is how now East India Company started thinking about cultivating tea in India. So in 1836.
So Neil Ferguson in his book Empire puts it really well. Of course, he's been criticized for it. He said the imperial expansion was based on England and Europe's addiction to coffee, sugar and cocoa and tea. So that's how it started.
Yes.
Yeah. But even then, till about the early 1900s, it was still a drink only the very anglicized and the British enjoyed. It hadn't permeated into households.
No. Because see, it was basically for export. Hmm. The tea cultivation was for export purpose. It was not for a domestic market. But then they realized that the half of the domestic consumption, tea for the domestic consumption, was imported from China. So that attracted the attention of people and the industry for cultivating this habit among the Indians and to make them tea addicted. So what they started first, there are phases how the advertisement campaign and propaganda campaign went about. So in 1904, they started distributing paise pack. What is paisa packet? It was a packet in which approximately 5 cups of tea could be made, and it cost only 1 paise. Okay, so they started distributing it to people to make them addicted, but that was not very successful. As I told you, it was a new drink and people were not habitual to it, so that was not very successful. Then again during the First World War, attempt was made to popularize tea, and much more intense campaign started, where these tea packets were distributed at different places like cinema halls or like industrial canteen, where people congregated. All these places, they started targeting people, distributed brew, tea brew, so that they should know what it looks like, how it tastes like. So that the reason that was that they should get addicted to it, they should get used to it, and then they should buy tea.
It wasn't easy to convince Indians to have tea. A lot of money was spent and every trick tried. From expensive ad campaigns to actually putting up tea stalls in railway stations and bus stops, where you will still find them. But there were few takers.
That was also not very successful. So in 1929, what happened? We have depression, world depression.
Yeah.
There was no demand. The export has stopped. So what to do with the excess production? So you have to use that excess production some way. So make people use it. Indians use it. And therefore now they started training people to publicize tea drinking. A training of college was, or training institute was started, where people were trained to give publicity to tea drinking. They were sent to different parts to popularize this drink. And that was a third stage. Okay. And then gradually the fourth stage arrived, where they started targeting towns. Important towns were located.
So it was a very concerted strategy.
Very.
In fact, I've heard it said, a lot of the tea stalls that you see in railway stations, in bus stops, the origins were from this
from
period.
From this place, yes.
Because the tea board actually set up these places to promote tea during travel, etc.
The railway station, ST stand, cinema hall, industrial canteens. When I was talking about towns, so some towns were identified, like Madras, Secunderabad, and other such towns were identified, and the areas were selected where in every household, these personnel used to go and teach the ladies of the house how to brew tea. So that once you get ladies of the house on your side, then half the battle.
We've seen the detergent companies, and a lot of companies do that now.
Same thing.
But you know, of course, Mahatma Gandhi was dead against tea. You know, and he's written extensively about the fact that tea is terrible and all of that. What did we have before that? What did domestic? I mean, I know in Kerala, for instance, you had something like a chas, which is a mora, which is really you know, curd in water with herbs. What did people have across the country?
We don't know. We did not have a concept of having a breakfast beverage. We had nothing like that. We did not have something to drink early in the morning when you get up. And if there were drinks, then it was very seasonal drinks. Like, for example, during the month of summers, you have a mango-based or raw mango-based drinks, or you can have a buttermilk. This type of drinks were there. Or we had some medicinal brews. For example, in Maharashtra, we have one grass, which is a lemon grass. And we prepare tea with the lemon grass. It does not have tea leaves in it. But it is called as a chai, or it is called gauti chaha, which is an Indian name for lemongrass. Or this was again for the medicinal purpose. It was not served to the guest as a drink.
The campaigns to lure people into drinking tea also saw a big political backlash. Leaders like Mahatma Gandhi openly criticized tea, and it soon came to be seen as a symbol of imperialism.
Tea was registered, and why it was registered? For different reasons. For medicinal reason, for social reason, for political reason, and for economic reason as well. Medicinal, because they thought that this is red in color, it looks like blood. Okay? And it was equal with intoxicating drink. Means tea equal to any intoxicating. It was equal to wine and all type of intoxicating.
So it was seen as an intoxicant?
Yes, yes.
Not as
not at all. To such an extent that those who were drinking tea would not do it openly. There was a tea shop in Girgaon in Mumbai where the curtains were placed so that outsiders should not easily see that people are drinking tea. Okay, then a very, very well-known Marathi author has mentioned in his autobiography that he used to go far away from his home to drink tea, not in his own area, not in his own lane, though there were some tea shops there. He would go to some far off region to have tea, because if anyone saw him drinking tea, then instantly they would have said that he is addicted to tea, like to very strong drink. So this was the idea.
But you know, I don't think there's any other place that I've seen such a hot place having such a hot drink and enjoying it. Because traditionally we didn't have a hot drink. It wasn't, you know, a norm, like you said.
So again, there, I'm sorry, I'm coming back to that propaganda and publicity, but that is what is done. So it was projected as a drink which energizes you, which gives
which
you
does,
extra
yeah.
Energy. It and especially the targeted working class. If coffee is targeted or coffee is seen as a drink of an elite, then tea was projected a drink of a common man, especially labor class, blue collared men. And it used to be expressed that this is the tea for those people who need extra energy, who need relief from the stress. Okay, and this is the drink which will not make you hungry for a long time.
But tea has become Indian now.
Totally.
You know, how has it become Indian according to you? What is the quintessential Indianness about the tea today?
I think it is the spices which we put in our tea. We put ginger or we put cardamom. And in some household, they have a spice mix to be put in the tea, which is called masala, chai ka masala. Every household will have their own chai ka masala. Especially Gujaratis are very much fond of their masala chais. So every community, every region has developed their own version of tea. But let me tell you one thing, and that is that common man in India do not enjoy the English tea. English in inverted comma, they don't like that light tea where you just add tea leaves to the boiling water. They like to boil and boil and boil their tea till it becomes very strong. And especially the truckers and those work people who are into hard labor, they like their khada chamach chai, which the tea they add 2-3 tablespoon of sugar.
So it's a potent mix.
It is potent mix.
My last question, and just a bit of trivia, what is the most Indian of Indian foods?
I think the use of spices, the combination and permutation of different spices, it gives so many varieties to food. Okay, we don't have one dish which you can say is common all over India. The name of the dish will be common, the technique will be common, but taste will differ from every nook and corner of India, and it is a use of spices.
And that's what makes tea also so special, right? Every state has its own version
yes.
of a spice tea. Well, thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you very much.